Welcome to the SAICA Biz Impact Podcast, your ultimate business growth platform, where we simplify complex business topics with expert insights, market-relevant trends, and practical advice, all aimed at keeping you ahead of the curve.
Welcome to another episode of the SAICA Biz Impact Podcast Show. I am your host, Lunqedo Mthwentwe. This is your home, this is your space, where we unpack and simplify complex business topics that affect your business or even your career on a day-to-day basis. And our aim is to really bring you the experts that are going to share some of the latest business trends and provide you with insights to stay ahead of your curve. And today, our topic is actually a very, very hot topic that impacts all of the small businesses that are out there, even individuals themselves. And that has to do with SARS and specifically with VAT. And to help us unpack such topic in terms of what it entails and what is currently happening in the country, we have a partner at Howard and Joel and Company, Tzippy Subotsky.
Tzippy, good morning.
Good to see you again.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Great. Tzippy, you're coming at a period again where we are, you know, dealing with a huge drive that is coming from SARS in terms of their collections. And we are aware that SARS has been meeting their targets in terms of collections. I mean, we understand that the economy is struggling, but most people struggle to understand that. How do you meet your target? How do you even exceed your target sometimes? I mean, while the economy is struggling like this, and one of the biggest drives that SARS has currently is collections and all types of taxes, and that includes VAT, all right? And most entrepreneurs, one of the questions that I usually get when we deal with some of our clients is to basically understand that, why am I paying VAT? Why am I paying company tax? Why am I paying individual tax? They feel that sometimes it's a double tax system where they're paying all of these taxes that are out there. So if you can just unpack to us in terms of, you know, what's the difference between VAT and your income tax that companies and individuals that would pay out there?
It's a very good question.
Yeah.
When I was thinking about this morning,
yeah,
you know, what is the difference between VAT and income tax?
Yeah.
I decided to go to the SARS website, and I'm going to quote what they've said. They've said that VAT is a mechanism to provide for taxation in respect of the supply of goods and services. So what does this mean? It's an indirect tax that is on the consumption of goods and services in the economy. Now, when people say, but we're paying income tax anyway, why are we also paying the VAT? You know, we're collecting our sales, this becomes part of our income. The actual matter of the fact is that it doesn't. It's not part of your income. When you go into the shops and you look at, you're going into a dress shop, for example, and you're going to buy a dress or a pair of pants or something, the item on the thing there says 350 Rand, 550 Rand. That amount includes VAT.
Yep.
When you're doing services, so as business owners, we're providing services to people. That, when we quote, often it doesn't include VAT. And people don't really understand, why do we have this?
Why don't we include VAT when we quote? Yeah.
So if you think back to the past, and still in the United States and in other countries, they've still got what they call a GST, a general sales tax.
Yeah.
Everything does not include that general sales tax. So whenever that they quote for anything, it doesn't include it. Now, a lot of people also don't realize that in South Africa, with regards to VAT, it's a value-added tax. As I said, it's on the it's for the consumption of goods and services in the economy. When you're quoting to anybody, what is going to be the sales price? If you don't say excluding VAT, you are deemed. In other words, there's a subtle expectation by law that the amount that you're quoting is inclusive of VAT. So if you're going to be quoting to somebody that your time is going to be 500 Rand an hour, if you don't say exclusive of VAT, that 500 Rand an hour now becomes inclusive, which means that the amount that you're making is less. Not that I want to scare anybody out there.
Yeah.
You know, but that is really what VAT is. It's It's a collection on your sales, so it's a sales tax on behalf of the government.
Yeah. So in a nutshell, it's not your money.
No, it is not your money.
It is government money.
Yes.
You are just in between to collect that tax and pay it over.
Yes.
To SARS.
Yes. Correct.
So if you are telling me right now, in terms of if I'm quoting and I don't include VAT, I don't include VAT. So now there's an expectation now that I need now to pay that money to SARS. So that means it will now, I will take from my margins right now.
Yes.
Okay. So can you call SARS, or when you are doing your submissions, to say, SARS, unfortunately, this revenue that I got, I did not include your VAT. So in that particular case, I can't pay you because I did not charge it. I did not collect it. All right. What happens in that particular situation?
So I'd love to say that I wish you can call SARS and say, sorry, I forgot to include you in my discussions with the client.
Yeah.
But that's not going to work. When you are declaring your turnover for the period, and as we know, VAT is for people earning under 30 million rand, it's done on a bi-monthly period.
Okay.
So let's say it's January, February, and you would be paying that in March. There, that would therefore include the VAT, and you would have to do the calculation to say, what is my sales after taking out that VAT?
Yeah.
So the words that often are used are gross and net.
Okay.
Gross of VAT would be inclusive. So that would be, in South Africa, VAT at the moment is 15%. Hopefully it will stay that way. There are rumors that they want to increase it. I really hope that they don't.
Mm.
But the net of the VAT would be the amount that you had originally thought in your example that you were going to get.
Yeah.
So if we take a very easy example, you're quoting 100 Rand. Exclusive of VAT, you add the 15%, makes it 115 Rand. That 15 Rand is then the VAT.
Yeah. Let's go back. Let's go back before we get into terms of how it's calculated and all of that. The question now will be, who is supposed to register for VAT? Because now you spoke about when you issue your code or when you issue your invoices, you need to charge VAT. Right. However, not each and every business out there is required to register for VAT. So take us through in terms of when do you become obligated to register for VAT, and when is it voluntary, and why would you just voluntary to register for VAT here?
Okay, that's an excellent question. And I think it is extremely relevant for our small businesses.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you why. First of all, the mandatory obligation to register. So mandatory registration is when you know or when you have reached 1 million rand in sales. So
at one go or else just in 12 months?
It's in 12 months.
Okay.
So people do think that it's going to be within a specific year, like in the financial year, but it's not. It's a rolling 12 months. So
what do you mean by that?
What do I mean by that?
Yeah.
So a financial year is, in South Africa, the most common year ends at in 28th of February.
Yes.
So a financial year would be the 1st of March to 28th of February.
Yes.
Now, a lot of people are only measuring their income on their annuals. So it's March to February.
March to February.
So if I've reached 1 million rand in that March to February, they think, okay, we need to. But what really they need to do is they need to say, we are in, where are we in October? So we're in October
November,
at the moment.
Yeah.
I've got to start looking at my sales figures from November last year.
Okay.
In order to see, have I met that 1 million rand target since November? And then in November, I will look from December.
Okay.
So that is what I mean by a rolling 12-month period. It is not the financial
year. It is not the financial year as per your company's financial year end from March to February.
That's
it's just the past 12 months since you've been trading.
Yes.
Have you made 1 million rand?
Yes. And the VAT Act specifically says not only when you have reached it, but if you know you're going to reach it. So for example, you've let's say reached 500,000 Rand, 600,000 Rand, and you are entering into a contract where you are going to be invoicing within the next few months 500,000 Rand for a big project.
Yeah.
Now you know you're going to be reaching that 1 million Rand, you're going to have to register. So that is compulsory registration.
Okay, that is compulsory. I have a follow-up question. I have a follow-up question for that in terms of compulsory registration. But what happens if you did not know? Or let's say, for instance, you have submitted a bid, 5 million. Remember, right now, you're not VAT registered. And said, okay, we will price you at 5 million. The chances of you getting that bid, you don't know. Now, your pricing now would have been no VAT at all. Then you get the project. Now, you're telling me now I need to register for VAT. What happens now with the person that has awarded me that bid to say, you said you're going to charge me 5 million. Now you're coming up now before we start the project that the total cost will be now 6.5 million inclusive of VAT. No, I'm not going to accept that. What happens in a situation like that? Because someone's going to say my budget was 5 million, not 6.5. Whose responsibility now it is in relation to that VAT?
So whenever you're pricing anything,
yeah,
you have to always be aware that there's going to be a VAT consequence.
Even if you're not registered.
Even if you're not registered.
Okay.
So I have seen contracts, and this is not really where I want to go today, but I'm going to use it as an example. Yeah. When you're selling a business as a going concern, you've got to mention that you're selling it as a going concern at a zero rate. Because if you don't mention that, then it's going to attract VAT at, if you're a VAT vendor, at the normal rate of 15%. But, so a person who is putting in a tender, they've got one of two options. The first one is they can go and register voluntarily, but there are things that they need to meet, requirements that they need to meet in order to be able to register voluntarily. Or, because at this point, remember, they haven't received the tender yet,
yeah,
so that would be voluntary. Yes. Or they can put into the tender, we are quoting you exclusive of that. If we get the tender, we will be registering for VAT, and therefore VAT will be applicable.
So you have to be proactive. You have to be proactive and protect yourself up front.
Yes.
All right. Let's talk now about voluntary. The number of people who are selling goods and services that turning over 300,000, 500,000, 700,000 rands, that is below that threshold you said is compulsory of 1 million rands. Then the people who are selling services, they're not buying anything. They're just using labor. That's it. So for them, doesn't benefit to even to be registered for that. When does it become beneficial, or why would you register voluntary for that?
So this is where it becomes very important, specifically for those industries that are putting out for tender. So you're requesting businesses and service providers to tender, to apply to do the work for you, right?
Yeah.
Most of them ask for specific documents. They won't even look at you if you're not registered for that. So you'll get a lot of startup companies that want to, they'll actually try and buy shelf companies with a VAT registration number because they want to, whether that is legal or not is a completely different discussion, which you're not going to go to today, because they want that VAT registration number in order to be able to put in their tender. I've been through this many times with many clients. It's a big problem because if you're not, so the voluntary registration, you have to meet a minimum of 50,000 rand in sales in order to be able and allowed to register for VAT.
So if I haven't sold goods below 50,000.
Yes.
I made 5,000 for the past 6 months. I've made 30,000.
Yes.
I can't register for that. So I need to have sold more than 50,000 rand.
Yes. Or at least have a contract for 50,000 rand.
Above that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this is a big problem in today's industry. We're all trying to get businesses off the ground. We're all trying to get money. We're trying to survive.
Yeah.
And then we get asked to apply for a tender. Now, it might not even be a big tender, but for some people, a contract that's going to be 20, 30,000 rand is big. It's the difference between, I don't know, getting something nice on the weekend or not. And I'm not talking about, you know, rugby tickets in France. I'm talking about, you know, just some, like, I don't know, nice chocolates for your kids or whatever. Sure. But that is needed. So people need to actually have invoiced out 50,000 rand and have the proof of that.
Yeah.
I don't know if you want me to talk about how to register, but that becomes quite technical.
No, that's, yeah.
So that's so we won't go.
No, let us not go there. As long we know that if you have made over 50,000 rands, you can register.
Yes.
And by the way, I think it's very important to note that SARS currently when you have to register for VAT, I think they've started to really scrutinize.
Yes.
Even they want those supporting documents now. It's no longer easy to register for VAT. Yeah?
It's not easy at all. They have they have made it in some cases easier than it used to be. Especially now since we don't have to go into a branch office with all our documents of proof. Now we can just send it through on e-filing or by email. But the registration process can take a while because SARS is very nervous of cases where people are trying to commit fraud. And it has to be mentioned that there are people out there who are trying to commit fraud and they just want to register in order to get the refunds. But the refunds might not even be real in order to be able to get registered. So SARS is looking they're making sure that you've got a place of where you actually work. Does it exist? Does your business exist? Are those invoices real in order to be able to register you for VAT?
Yeah. Let's talk about, I mean, you said VAT, first of all, it's not your money.
Yes.
You know, you as a business, you're just in between to collect and pay it over to SARS and claim your input as well. But let's talk about the struggle that most businesses have, which is the ability now, once they've collected that money from SARS, then they need to keep it for 2 months and pay it over to SARS after 2 months. I think most businesses in South Africa, they operate like that, as you have said. Then you find that now, when it is time to pay that VAT money to SARS, it has been utilized. What are the methods or what is your advice around that in terms of, you can't be in a situation where you've collected, now it's time to pay, the money has been used. What now?
Right. So it goes back to basic cash flow planning. One of the things that I do advise, and this is something you'd have to get into a good habit to do. So it's creating habits in order to be able to do this regularly.
Discipline,
Yes. Is what we've just got to remember that there are two ways to pay VAT. There's the payment basis and there's the invoice basis. Now, most businesses are on the invoice basis. So it does become a little bit more difficult on what I'm going to say, but it is still a good discipline to have when you are going to have to plan to pay the VAT.
Okay.
When you collect the money, so you're invoicing your client and they're going to pay you. Hopefully, they're going to pay you within the 30 days. It's very nice if they're paying on delivery, but that often doesn't happen. The money that comes into your bank account, what I advise my clients is to do, is to take 15% of that, which is the VAT amount, and to actually put that aside into another bank account so that that money is kept for when you need to pay the VAT. Yes, you are going to often have what we call inputs, which is the VAT claims against what you've got to pay. So what you're paying, all your expenses, which attract VAT, that you can take off that amount.
Yeah.
That will reduce the amount to go through to SARS because somebody else is paying that to SARS.
Correct.
However, if you keep that amount on the side, you should be able to pay that VAT when the time comes, but at the end of the period.
It's 2 months to be, you know, for me to have that money, that's, especially with SMEs, you know, they'll tell you that I've been sitting with this money for too long and there are challenges that keep coming every month in my business. So I ended up now tapping into that money that I should have put it aside, right?
Yes. So yes, that is, it's a big, big struggle.
Yeah.
And it's one of the things that is the reason why I'm not so in favor of them raising the VAT rate. Because it's not just the small businesses. We're talking individuals as well, who now with our limited income need to put aside money that's now going to go even more to the government. It's going to eat even more into our basket of what's available to spend.
Yeah.
And it's the same with the businesses. We're still spending the same amount on salaries, on rent, on whatever it is that we need to spend it on, and yet we've still got to find that cash. So by having that discipline, what one can do is one can pull a report from their software every week, hoping people are using software to calculate, I have invoiced out 100,000 Rand. So I've got to make sure that I've got, of that 100,000 Rand, I've got to make sure that I've got the amount that goes into the bank account.
Yeah.
However, when you're doing it that way, there you could automatically take in the input. So it could be a lower amount.
Sure.
So you can already, sorry, when I say inputs, the expenses, mm-hmm. you can already take that into account when you're putting it away. But the nice thing is if you are putting it away to pay the VAT, yeah. then at the end of the month, when you've paid it and you've got a little bit left over, yeah. either you keep it for the next period,
yeah, next period
or yeah. you can say, okay, of that, over-expected or I over-calculated 20,000 Rand, I can use that in my business and I can take that
the benefits,
back.
Yeah.
So there are benefits yeah. in that. South Africans yeah. have a very low rate of savings. So it is also a way of
yes.
saving.
Yes.
And hopefully you're putting it into a little account that's attracting interest. Interest is VAT-free.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
you don't have to worry about that. It's not tax-free though. So
sure.
when we're yeah. going to deal with yeah. income tax, that's a different discussion as well. But that is just one method that I okay. do tell people to okay. to put their yeah. money aside.
Now, let's talk about the penalties.
Yes.
Now, what happens if you have invoiced, 1 million rands, and you're supposed to pay 150,000 rands of VAT, and comes that period, you don't have the 150,000 rands. Now, take us through what are the penalties, because that's where SARS is really collecting quite a lot, and that's where the meat in the targets is around the penalties and the interest that they are charging on late payments. So what are the penalties and the interest that are there on late payments?
Okay, there's two dates.
Yeah.
If you're paying, in the past, we would submit a manual VAT return into SARS, and that would have to go in by the 25th, and then the payment would have to be made by the 25th of the period, of the following
month. Yeah.
So if we use our example of January, February,
yeah.
right, which is the period, so you'd have to pay it by the 25th of March. However, because we are all e-filing now, mm. we're allowed to make the payment on the 30th. Or the 31st of March, sorry.
So
unless the 31st yeah. is a Saturday, in which case you'd have to pay it by the 30th.
So you submit by the 25th?
Yes.
You can make the payment by the month end, by the 30th,
so you actually
right?
can submit by the month end as well.
So it's no longer by the 25th.
It's no longer by the 25th.
You can also submit your VAT
yes.
return the following month by the 30th.
Yes. So,
okay.
so January, February.
Yeah.
Your period ends the 28th of February. You have to submit it by the end of March.
Yes.
Now, as long as the end of March is not a Saturday, you'd have to do it on the Friday.
Yeah.
Okay. So
yeah.
it would have to be on the last day of the okay. of the last business day of the month.
Yeah.
You will find if you do submit your VAT return before the 25th, but you only pay it, if you were to print a statement of account, you will have a penalty already on the 26th.
Yes.
However, you pay it by the 30th, the 31st, that penalty disappears. So I think it's very important that
yeah.
people know that.
Yeah.
Also, there is something just to know that a lot of times there's something in the SARS system where as soon as you've submitted your VAT return,
yes.
even if you've paid it, but for some reason it's not reflecting, you may get a thing saying that you are not compliant. Don't stress about it. If you know that you've paid, you've got proof of payment, you have submitted, you are compliant. So you don't have to worry about that. Everybody freaks out and they get very nervous. If, however, you haven't paid by the last day of the month, on the first day of the next month, there is going to be a penalty.
Yeah.
And that penalty does need to get paid.
That's the 10% penalty.
And that is the 10% penalty.
Yeah. Yeah.
yeah. Now, so you've got the penalty.
Yeah.
You also are going to start attracting interest on a daily basis.
How much is that interest?
So that interest is the interest as prescribed. In the Act, I think at the moment it's between 8 and 10%.
Yeah.
I do stand to be corrected. So, but that is an annual rate that
sure.
you would then divide by
yeah.
by 365. So it
yeah.
would be by the amount of
daily,
days.
As you said.
Now, something that a lot of people aren't aware of is that if you are delayed, you are going to have to pay interest. Now, if you've got a refund due to you and SARS doesn't pay you, by the time they're supposed to pay you. So there is they'll probably do a little bit of a check, and then there are certain days as prescribed in the Tax Administration Act when they've got to refund you. There's interest that kicks in from there. Now, often people don't know about that interest. So I think it is
yeah.
very important
yeah.
to mention that as a taxpayer, we are also it's a lower rate of interest, but we are also entitled to interest. So if there's ever a dispute or anything like that, we need to apply for that interest to be paid to us mm. as the taxpayer.
Sure. And that has been, a big call for most taxpayers to say, but if I don't pay, you follow up on me that I should pay an interest. But if you owe me, you delay now to refund me back. Am I getting interest as well? Since if I'm late, I'm charged. But if you are late in SARS, I need to be getting interest in that money because it has an impact on the cash flow.
Yes, absolutely.
Operations, right?
Yeah. Absolutely, especially when it comes to VAT. There are specific cases where SARS must pay interest on refunds, and there are certain cases that they do not pay interest.
Okay.
And that, but it's not VAT. VAT refund, you are entitled to interest. Unfortunately, you don't. You're not entitled to a penalty.
No, that's great.
But you do have to pay the penalty if you are late.
Let's talk about now. You spoke about the habits and all of that. And habits, of course, you need to be efficient in terms of how you do things as well. So let's talk about automation. What are some of the tools that are out there that can help now the SMEs or the business owners to really not fall into that manual trap of even sometimes even forgetting to submit your VAT return? What is out there? What tools can they use?
Okay, so we can actually start with very simple,
especially
since you mentioned forgetting.
Yeah.
The first thing that a person can do is actually put a calendar reminder in their phone. So if you, or in their calendar, if you know that you have to submit your VAT returns by the end of March, May, July, make sure that on the 20th of March, the 20th of May, the 20th of July, you get a reminder to prepare that return and submit it to SARS. And make sure that you've got a second reminder at the last business day of the month to make sure that you pay. So I think that's the first automation that you can do. We all know how to work the calendar functionality of our phones, of our computers. It's very so that is the first thing that you can do. And you can just set it for every 2 months without fail. When it comes to actually the accounting side of it.
Yeah.
So there are still those businesses who still like to invoice through document packages or spreadsheets, but it's actually worthwhile to invest in, there are free packages out there, but in an accounting package where you invoice, where the calculation is created and reports can be made to see how much VAT you are owing on your sales and how much VAT you can expect to claim back on your expenses. And those, most of those packages have got automated reporting functionalities that would allow you to create those reports, and they can fit into your other reminders.
Yeah.
Another good way is to have a good accountant or a good bookkeeper.
Talking about having a very good accountant, should a taxpayer use an accountant or use a tax practitioner to really deal with the tax affairs of their company? Because there are bookkeepers who are not tax practitioners. Why should a taxpayer use the services of a tax practitioner to assist in relation to their tax affairs?
So a tax practitioner is trained and is guided by a code of ethics to ensure that their clients are compliant. There are rules for accountants, tax practitioners, and everything in between, which are governed by the term non-compliance of laws and regulations, which as accountants we call NOCLA.
Okay.
We have an obligation that if somebody is not being compliant, we have to report them as accountants, as tax practitioners. And it's not just for SARS, it's for all the different regulations that we use. So if you are going to be using a tax practitioner, you know that you are doing one step extra to make sure that you remain compliant.
Yeah.
Now, yes, of course, there are going to be those tax practitioners and those bookkeepers and those accountants who may, either their efficiencies are not correct or things can fall through the cracks. We are human at the end of the day.
Absolutely.
But hopefully they have the automation processes to assist their clients and their taxpayers to be able to submit on time. And the way that that would work is if you are engaging with a bookkeeper who's a tax practitioner or an accountant who's a tax practitioner, you will be sending your sales figures, whether it be through the bookkeeping software, the accounting software, or if it's sending them the documents by email or through a portal on the internet or something, every month, and they will calculate it and remind you as well. So they could have the reminder set up. Yeah. You know, at the end of the day, all a business person really wants to do is do their business and make some money.
Yeah.
So by having the tax practitioner or the accountant, who should be both, on their side, they're taking a whole chunk of responsibility and allowing somebody else to worry about it, and then just remind them when they need to pay and when they need to authorize the submission.
Trusted business advisor. So any tips there in relation to the listeners and the viewers in terms of how to navigate the VAT issue? Because it is there. They usually say you can avoid so many things in life, but some of the things that you can avoid, that includes taxes. So what are your tips? What are your parting shots in relation to how do you really navigate that as a small business owner?
So first of all, accept it. Accept that VAT is a reality.
Yeah.
I think that is a step that will really help. Second of all, have a trusted business advisor. Have a trusted tax practitioner who works together with you and that helps you plan to make sure that at the end of every period, you have got sufficient funds to meet all your expenses, including SARS. The third thing is, it's very difficult, especially if you're a business in the services industry, to make sure that you can utilize all the expenses, but make sure that you are. So for example, if you're in services, you're still purchasing equipment, computers, phones that are attracting VAT. Yeah. Make sure to buy from registered VAT vendors. I'm not saying don't support the small business person who's not a registered VAT vendor, because they're not going to survive if we do that.
Yeah.
But be clever in the way that you do things. Make sure to get your tax invoices from the service providers that you are purchasing from.
Yeah.
For example, I'll just use this as an example. I got a phone the other day and I needed to go and get a cover. So one of the things, I use the phone for business, I'm able to claim on that.
Yeah.
One of the things I said to them is, please give me the tax invoice. I can use that. SARS is going to ask for that.
Yeah.
So make sure that you've got those tax invoices so that what you are claiming to reduce your VAT is valid and is real.
Yeah.
Besides for that, it's not that easy to reduce the VAT more than that. We can only go according to the rules. There are no loopholes when it comes to VAT. There are certain ways that you can create it. You can say, you know, I know this client isn't going to pay me within the required time, so therefore I'm only going to invoice them later. It's a tip that you can do, provided that you're not providing that service before, because that is on earlier of accrual payment. And accrual is when you do the service. So even if you haven't invoiced it, difficult to prove though.
Yeah.
So you can say, look, I'm only going to invoice you next month because I'm only doing the work for you next month. So therefore, and you're only going to pay me within that period. So you can plan it that way.
Mm.
Otherwise, make sure that all the decisions that you make are together with your advisor.
Yeah. Talking about that, before you leave, in a situation where you have invoiced and you're going to be paid after 3 months. Now, I've invoiced R1 million. However, I'm not going to get my payment in 30 days. My agreement with my supplier is that they're going to pay me in 60 or 90 days. So am I expected now to pay VAT while I have not received the cash, because you spoke about now in accrual, and I only have 150,000 from there? How do you deal with that? That's a huge amount. And that's a reality of SMEs,
It's education, unfortunately. Sure. Unfortunately, the reality is that, yes, you have to pay that VAT.
Okay.
There are methodologies that people do employ I don't want to go into them because they can be misconstrued. And I don't want people going and doing things that are not ethical. But there are ways. My suggestion is that if you know that there's going to be a long delay in payment, try and delay the invoice, especially if you're not doing the work yet. But also divide that invoice in three, maybe. Say, I'm going to invoice you over 3 months. You can pay me over 3 months.
Sure.
So that's also a way to do that.
Okay. Tzippy, thank you so much. This has been a very fruitful discussion. And I know that SMEs out there, tax is actually on their priority list. And they need to understand that VAT is not only just for them. However, VAT is money that belongs to SARS, so it needs to be paid over to that. We have come to an end of our show. And my key takeaway around this discussion is that ensure that when it comes to VAT, when that money comes into your bank account, put it away. Don't even keep it into your main bank account to ensure that when it's time to pay in 2 months' time, that money is there, it's available, it was earning interest on any other way. So discipline as well is another important part. You have to be disciplined as an SME business owner. Make sure in relation to that, that you know your roles, you know your responsibilities. Have a tax practitioner close to you. That's very important because those are the people that are going to advise you some of the mechanisms on how to reduce VAT. I hope you have learned some lessons that you will implement going forward. Let us know what you think of this episode. And please don't forget to follow SAICA on LinkedIn, on Twitter, and Instagram to actually have access as well to our podcast shows. So don't forget to share this content with all the people that you know might benefit from it. Subscribe and like the page. That's it from me, Ulungcedo Mthwentwe. See you on the next one.
The SAICA Biz Impact Podcast is proudly brought to you by SAICA, committed to growing impactful businesses in collaboration with our SAICA accredited practitioners. Don't forget to subscribe to our podcast and visit our website for more valuable resources.